forever. Your faithfulness is as enduring as the heavens. Let's pray. Father, Calvary does cover it all. Without Calvary, there would be no church. There would be no salvation. There would be no heaven. And so we gather as a people of God this morning in the house of God to worship you and to offer up our praise and thanksgiving for your unfailing love for us. As your word says, in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. God commendeth his love toward us. Oh, how thankful we are for that this morning. Some of us may be missing some things in life, Father, for which we would desire to have. But the fact that we know you as our Lord and Savior, our names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life in heaven, there is ample reason to praise you this morning. Some may have come this morning with heavy hearts. Some may come this morning with burdens they're carrying for things they are facing, things they're going to face. I'm reminded of that great, great little chorus that says, burdens are lifted at Calvary. He was wounded for our transgressions, bruised for our iniquities, chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed. Father, we have every reason just to praise you this morning. As we gather as your people this morning, as we engage in singing the great hymns of the church, we pray that you'd bless us. Pray the Holy Spirit would bring comfort to those who need comfort, conviction to those who need conviction this morning. May above everything else, the Lord Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior, be honored and glorified in everything that we do today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen.
Once again, we welcome everyone to our service today. We're glad that you're here. Let's begin or continue. Our first song this morning is, Oh, How He Loves You and Me. So let's stand together and sing. If you're using a hymnal, it's number 349.
So let me ask you to come to the altar for a time of prayer, and especially ask the deacons to gather around a little prayer box or our treasure box, as Ted calls it. Let me give you a couple of updates. Mr. Larry Bryant was taken to CMC from PMC on Friday evening. Talked to Judy last evening. They're hoping to get some kind of diagnosis on Monday. He's about the same as he was last Sunday. I told her we'd have special prayer for Mr. Larry this morning. We do miss him. Nancy Brakefield's sister has been moved from CMC in Charlotte. She is in rehab at Panville. And there are a whole lot of other names there. I ask you to please take note of them. And so let's pray this morning. Names in this box of people that you've placed there who are either unsaved or unchurched. I believe that God answers prayer.
Amen.
I've even heard the results already from prayer, people whose names were placed in this box. We live in a tumultuous times, difficult times, any way you want to describe it. There's one answer, and his name is Jesus. And the cross of Christ, it's never been a time when we need as Christians to hold up the cross of Jesus more than today. And Father, we do that. We are a thankful, thankful, thankful people. We could never say thank you enough this morning. We spent the entire hour this morning. just say thank you. We could that really would not be adequate, Father. We thank you for all of your blessings. We thank you for the fact that we have a church and we're here and we're free to worship this morning, unlike so many people around the world this morning who do not have this freedom. Thank you for it. And Father, I pray especially for Mr. Larry this morning. We miss him again this Sunday. We pray that the doctors who are treating him there at CMC, Father, we pray they're going to be able to come to kindred mind and Father, tell his family what his needs are and what they need to do to bring him back to the health that he once knew. Pray you bless him this morning. Make him and his family mindful. We're praying for them this morning. I pray for Miss Nancy's sister, Father, who's in rehab this morning. I pray you bless her. I pray for all of these names on this prayer list this morning, Father, as I pray for every person here this morning who may be going through a difficult time. I pray especially for the names in this box. There's some of my own this morning, some of my family, probably the men whose hands are placed upon this box and the people who gather around this altar this morning have somebody in this box, Father, we're deeply concerned about. And so, Lord, we just want to pray that the Holy Spirit of God, whoever those people may be this morning, some may even be in this building. Some are in other places this morning. Father, there is nowhere in the world that somebody is out of the reach of Almighty God, and I thank you for that. That's why we pray, Father, because the Holy Spirit has the power to work in their heart and minds and lives, wherever they may be this morning. Father, we're praying that. We're praying that when year's end comes, Father, there are going to be many of these people who have come to a saving knowledge of Jesus or have returned, Father, to their faith. I pray if there's someone here this morning who doesn't know Jesus, I pray the Holy Spirit would move in that. Thank you for Thomas. Oh, Father, how grateful we are for a young man like Thomas, and we pray as he stands a little later to preach your word, we pray you'd empower him with the Holy Spirit. We pray you'd bless all that we do this day for your name's honor and your name's glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
As we get ready for Easter, be reminded our choir will be presenting the musical program next Sunday morning on Palm Sunday. And then, of course, Easter is the 21st, and that's also the day of our sunrise service meeting at Filbert Presbyterian Church at 7 o'clock. So don't forget about that on Easter Sunday morning. Our next song is Hallelujah, What a Savior. Let's stand together and sing. It's number 311 in your hymnal.
Thank you.
Our song this morning before our offering time is number 348, My Savior's Love. How marvelous, how wonderful. So let's sing together all verses, and then it'll be time for our morning offering. Father, we give you thanks for this day. We thank you for the many blessings of it. Father, we come and praise you for all your mighty, glorious power. Father, with music and singing, we celebrate your mighty acts. Father, we just come praising you with all our hearts. Father, we might again wonder about that treasure chest. But Father, we might think, what shall a man profit if he gain the whole world but loses his own soul? Yes. And Father, as I am amidst with my brothers, and some might say, well, why isn't Bobby's name or why isn't Jackie's name in that box? Father, everybody's name don't need to be in there. Father, some of us can say, Lord, for I know whom I have believed in. And am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I've committed unto him against that day. Father, we give you thanks. Thank you, O God. We praise your name. Father, we often can say,
Who am I that a king would bleed and die for? Thank you, Jesus. It's in that name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Praise God. What an honor it is to be in His house this morning. The soldiers tried to clear the narrow street, but the crowd pressed in to see the man condemned to die on Calvary. He was bleeding from a beating. There were stripes upon his back, and he wore a crown of thorns upon his head. And he bore with every step the scorn of those who cried out for his death. Down the Via Dolorosa, on the way of suffering, like a lamb in the Messiah, Christ our King. And He chose to walk that road out of His love for you and me. Down the Via Dolorosa, all the way to Calvary. Thank you.
the souls of all men made its way to the heart of Jerusalem. Down the Via Dolorosa, a way of suffering, like a lamb laid on the Messiah, Christ our King. And he chose to walk that road out of his love for you and me. Down the Via Dolorosa, all the way to Calvary.
The Son of God hung his head and he cried, "It is finished." God bless you. Thank you.
Bless you. This next song is the greatest, I think, of the greatest love story on earth. Please join in with us in the end at the chorus of it. Gates and doors were barred, all fastened down. I spent the night in sleeplessness and rose at every sound. Half in hope of sorrow and half in fear the day would find the soldiers breaking through to drag us all away. Just before the sunrise, I heard something at the wall. A gate began to rattle and a voice began to call. I hurried to the window and looked down into the street, expecting swords and torches and the sounds of soldiers' feet. There was no one there but Mary, and I went down to let her in. John stood there beside me as she told us where she'd been. She said they moved him in the night and none of us knows where. The stone's been rolled away and now his body isn't there. We both ran toward the garden, then John ran on ahead. We found the stone and the empty tomb just the way that Mary said. But the winding sheet they'd wrapped him in was just an empty shell. How or where they'd taken him was more than I could tell. Something strange had happened there, but just what I did not know. John believed a miracle, but I just turned to go. Circumstances, speculation couldn't lift me very high, cause I'd seen them crucify him and then I watched him die. Back inside the house again, all my guilt and anguish came. Everything I'd promised him just added to my shame. When at last it came to choices, I denied I knew his name.
I denied I knew his name.
Even if he were alive, it wouldn't be the same. Suddenly, the air was filled with a strange and sweet perfume. light that came from everywhere drove shadows from the room. Jesus stood before me with his arms held open wide. I fell down on my knees and I clung to him and cried. As he raised me to my feet, and then I looked into his eyes. Love was shining out from him like sunlight from the sky. Guilt and my confusion disappeared in sweet release. Every fear I'd ever had just faded in sweet peace. Stand if you can. Please stand.
He's alive. He's alive. He's alive and am forgiven. Heaven's gates are open wide. He's alive. He's alive. He's alive and I am forgiven. Heaven's gates are open wide. He's alive. He's alive. He's alive and I am forgiven. Heaven's gates are open wide. He's alive. He's alive. He's alive.
Time I've seen quite a few young men hear God's call to preach. I can honestly say to you, I have never had met a young man who quite like Thomas. God has great things in store for Thomas. I've told you that before. We're just honored again, Thomas, that you can come. He'll be going back to seminary tomorrow, and we're just glad that you could come and share God's word with us this morning. We love you, appreciate you. We pray for you every single day. God bless you.
Bible with you this morning, open it up to Isaiah chapter 53. Isaiah chapter 53, please. Who has believed what we have heard, and to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? He grew up before him like a young plant, and like a root out of the dry ground. He didn't have an impressive form or majesty that we should look at him, no appearance that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by men, a man of suffering who knew what sickness was. He was like someone people turned away from. He was despised, and we didn't value him. Yet he himself bore our sickness, and he carried our pains, but we in turn regarded him stricken, struck down by God, and afflicted. But he was pierced because of our rebellion, crushed because of our iniquities. Punishment for our peace was on him, and we are healed by his wounds. We all went astray like sheep. We all have turned to our own way, and the Lord has punished him for the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. Like a lamb led to the slaughter, and like a sheep silent before the shearer, he did not open his mouth. He was taken away because of the oppression and judgment, and who considered his fate? For he was cut off from the land of the living. He was struck because of my people's rebellion. He was assigned a grave with the wicked, but he was with a rich man at his death, because he had done no violence and had not spoken deceitfully. Yet the Lord was pleased to crush him severely. When you make him a guilt offering, he will see his seed. He will prolong his days, and by his hand the Lord's pleasure will be accomplished. After his anguish, he will see light and be satisfied by his knowledge. My righteous servant will justify many, and he will carry their iniquities. Therefore I will give him the many as a portion, and he will receive the mighty as a spoil, because he willingly submitted to death and was counted among the rebels, yet he bore the sins of many and interceded for the rebels. May God bless the reading of his word.
Amen. Keep your Bibles out and turn with me over to 1 Corinthians chapter 15. 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Well, I stand before you this morning with a gloriously weighty task. And to be clear, I think that any given preacher in any given church on any given Lord's Day has a weighty task. But when I, as a half-cocked 22-year-old, a semester and a half into seminary, when I tell you to open your Bibles to 1 Corinthians 15, I am interjecting myself into a long line of gospel proclaimers who have been overwhelmed by the glory of the witness that God has left for us in this chapter, and as a result have taken to the pulpit with the hope and with the prayer that God might use the message that follows in a mighty way to bring encouragement, to present a challenge, to bring conviction, to offer life application. In the midst of that weight, there is also a great eagerness. The Puritan theologian John Owen said, "I think truly that no man preaches that sermon well to others that he does not first preach to his own heart." And I can assure you that I have done that. I have preached myself the essence of this sermon countless times. And I can look back at times in my life and see where I was in need of this sermon, but I didn't know that I ought to preach it to myself. And in many of those times, usually in a dorm room by myself, the Holy Spirit, through the reading of the Word, made the basis of this sermon clear to me. And it didn't necessarily come from this particular text. It didn't typically last 30 minutes. I can't say I've ever had any notes. It usually hasn't been all that articulate. And I've preached it to myself many times when I didn't even have a Bible on me. But only God knows how many times this sermon has preserved me. Only God knows how many times this sermon has prevented me from caving to professors I've had in the past. Only God knows how many times this sermon has delivered me from my peers. Only God knows how many times this sermon has restored me when I've been tested. Only God knows how many times this sermon has simply allowed me to hold on in seasons of my life where sin has kicked my teeth in. Because no matter how many times Satan has tempted me to try to find a way around Jesus, I have never come close to finding a way around the resurrection. I guess you could say it's a little bit personal. So let's read the text. 1 Corinthians, beginning in verse 1, reading through verse 8. Paul writes, "Now, I want to make clear for you, brothers and sisters, the gospel I preached to you, which you received, on which you have taken your stand, and by which you are being saved, if you hold to the message I preached to you, unless you believed in vain. For I passed on to you, as most important, what I also received, that Christ died for our sins, according to the Scriptures, that he was buried, he was raised on the third day, according to the Scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas, then to the 12. Then he appeared to over 500 brothers and sisters at one time. Most of them are still alive, but some have fallen asleep. Then he appeared to James, and to all the apostles. Last of all, as to one born at the wrong time, he also appeared to me. I undoubtedly and unapologetically stand before you this morning with the aim of defending the resurrection. But I don't come with any tricks up my sleeve. I don't have any fancy theories in my head. I'm not here to chop logic. I'm just going to go about this Spurgeon style. Spurgeon liked to use this illustration. I think it's very fitting. He said, the word of God is like a lion. You don't have to defend a lion. All you do is let the lion loose. The lion will defend itself. So I'm simply trying to stay out of the way this morning and let the lion do its thing. And you can put your money wherever you want to, but I'm going to bet on the lion. So as we approach 1 Corinthians 15, I think we would do well to remind ourselves of the context of this passage. You don't have to read 1 Corinthians very long to see that the church in Corinth has some problems, and that is to say the absolute least. Here are some of the most obvious problems. In chapter 1 and chapter 3, there are divisions within the church based on who their favorite preacher is. Some say, I follow Paul. Some say, I follow Apollos. Others say, I follow Peter. Now, a modern-day equivalent of that would be like us subdividing ourselves in the church, and we segregate ourselves based off of which preacher we like. So we got the Piper fans back here, the MacArthur fans up here, the Stanley fans can sit up here, and the people that still watch Billy Graham on YouTube have to sit up here. And Paul has to step in and remind them, we're all following Jesus, because they seem to have forgotten that. Then in chapter 5, a member of the church is practicing sexual immorality of a kind that is not even tolerated among the pagans. So the citizens of Corinth, the outsiders, are looking at the Christians in the church in Corinth and saying, those are some messed up people. Chapter 6, people in the same church, in the same local body of believers, are suing one another. They're taking one another to court. They have no idea how to biblically resolve conflict. Chapter 8, they're having a hard time deciding what to do about eating food offered to idols. Not something that particularly applies to us per se, but in first century Corinth, it was a problem. Chapter 11, in the first part of chapter 11, they are apparently having a hard time understanding biblical gender roles. And then in the latter part, their divisions are carrying over to the Lord's Supper. They're discriminating on the basis of rich and poor now. The poor seem to be excluded. Meanwhile, the rich people are eating their backs out and getting drunk at the Lord's Supper. You could say we've got a problem there. Chapter 12, they are apparently dividing themselves over who has what spiritual gift. And then in chapter 14, they're misusing their spiritual gifts. So Paul instructs them how they should properly use their spiritual gifts. And then here we are at the beginning of chapter 15. Now, in light of all of that, everything going on at the church in Corinth, we should pay special attention to how this chapter begins. Look at verse 1. Now, I want to make clear for you, brothers and sisters, the gospel I preach to you. After 14 chapters where Paul has essentially cited problems and offered reproof and corrections, he's getting ready to bring this letter to a close, and he's touched on these huge issues, issues that threaten to wreck this church, issues that are ruining these people's witness, issues that demand discipline. And after all of that, Paul says, hey, remember the gospel. Now, you don't have to know much about the Bible. You don't have to know much about the gospel. You don't even have to know what the gospel is to see that apparently the gospel is pretty foundational. If Paul has spent 14 chapters dealing with a variety of serious issues, then he says the ultimate solution is y'all need to remember the gospel. It's pretty clear to see that the gospel is the key. Notice that Paul has called these people brothers and sisters. He believes them to be Christians, which is helpful for us because he's about to give us a lot of insight into what a Christian is. Look at verse 1 again. Now, I want to make clear for you, brothers and sisters, the gospel I preach to you, which you received. So Paul hasn't even defined the gospel yet in this chapter, though he's certainly about to. But he says that a Christian is someone who has received the gospel. The gospel has made it to them. They have heard the gospel. Now understand this, no cognizant person can be saved apart from hearing the gospel. That's not a particularly popular statement, but according to Romans 1, according to Romans 10, it is a biblical statement. And if it's a biblical statement, then it's a true statement. And if it's a true statement, it's a statement that we should act on. 3 billion people in this world right now who don't even know a Christian. 3 billion people in this world who don't know anyone who could tell them the gospel if they wanted to know the gospel. Someone must take them the gospel. Revelation 5:9 tells us that Jesus has ransomed people for God from every tribe and language and people and nation. So therefore, someone is going to take them the gospel. Why not you? It's good that we care about our community. It's good that we care about our neighbors, the ones we can talk to and the ones that we can drive to. And it's good because Christians care about all suffering. But Christians especially care about eternal suffering. There are 3 billion people in this world right now whose greatest need isn't a blanket or a coat or firewood or a wheelchair ramp or an irrigation system or a fruit basket. They need the pure, unadulterated gospel of Jesus Christ, or they are going to die and go to hell. The Great Commission says it's our responsibility to get it to them. What's your role? And are you playing your role to get it to them? Christian is someone who has received the gospel, but that is not all. Look again at verse 1. Now, I want to make clear for you, brothers and sisters, the gospel I preached to you, which you received, on which you have taken your stand. I spent a good bit of time in one of my sermons this past summer talking about what it means to believe something, but I should have just turned right here because this is about as clear as it gets. Ultimately, salvation isn't about what you know, it isn't about what you think, it isn't about whether you've participated in some ritual or not. Salvation's about what you've taken your stand on. I've said it before, I'll say it again, I plan to spend the rest of my life trying to convince people of the truth of this, and that is that no one cares that you think Jesus was a real person. Jesus is the most well-attested to person in all of antiquity. No rational people dispute his existence. No one cares that you think Jesus was crucified. Again, very well documented. It's attested to in secular sources, attested to in anti-Christian sources. Rational people don't dispute that Jesus was crucified. No one cares that you think Jesus was resurrected. There have been about 10 counter theories proposed in the last 2,000 years to explain away the resurrection, and they all fall flat on their face. Because when you look at the actual data, the fact that Jesus walked out of the tomb fits the facts better than any other explanation imaginable. So it's fine that you think those things, but do you believe those things? Have you taken your stand in those things? Look at verse 2. If you receive the gospel and take your stand in the gospel, what is the result? Verse 2, and by which you are being saved. Let's just remind ourselves what we are being saved from. It's very, very clear what Paul understands that we need to be saved from. Perhaps nowhere clearer than Romans chapter 3. In verse 10 of Romans chapter 3, Paul begins quoting from Psalm 14, and here's what he says. There is no one righteous, not even one. There is no one who understands. There is no one who seeks God. All have turned away. They have together become worthless. There is no one who does good, not even one. So, according to God's word, we're all sinners. I'm a sinner, you're a sinner, the preacher's a sinner, Miss Mary's a sinner, Bill Wood's a sinner. It's not just like sin does a little bit of cosmetic damage to us. It's not like sin just takes us and makes us some kind of fixer-upper type salvage project for God. Romans 3 just said our sin has made us worthless. We're not worthy of any type of salvage. We're worthy of destruction. But there's something else going on that alerts us to our desperate need for salvation. That is, while we are stuck in our worthlessness, God is infinitely worthy. He is holy. He is altogether different from us in terms of goodness. So in light of who we are, when we look at God, his wrath towards sin and sinful people is absolutely just and absolutely righteous and absolutely deserved. The concept of salvation is salvation from God's just and right response towards sinners, which honestly creates a new question for us. If we can say that God's righteous and just response to sinners is their destruction, how can God also be righteous and just to save us? Paul gives one more insight about who a Christian is before he answers that exact question. So look again in verse 2. By which you are being saved if you hold to the message I preached to you, unless you believed in vain. So a Christian is someone who receives the gospel, who takes their stand in the gospel, and now someone who holds fast to the gospel. Paul is not saying that a person who doesn't hold fast to the gospel has lost their salvation. He's saying that a person who doesn't hold fast to the gospel never had any salvation to lose. He's saying that you have believed in vain. This is very, very similar to what the Apostle John writes in 1 John 2:19. They went out from us, but they did not belong to us. For if they had belonged to us, they would have remained with us. Very clearly, we're talking about two different groups of people here. However, they went out so that it might be made clear that none of them belongs to us. Someone who doesn't hold fast to the gospel doesn't lose their salvation. They simply reveal that they were never saved in the first place. Take heed, though, because believing in vain may allow you to look like a Christian for a while. You can believe in vain and fool some people. You can believe in vain and fool yourself. It's happened to me. But ultimately, when someone who has believed in vain takes a real sober look at their life, the fruit that they bear shows that they aren't holding fast to the gospel. It's not really the foundation they're standing on. If that's you, then beware, because Paul says that believing in vain does not lead to salvation. Look at verse 3. So Paul has promised to make the gospel clear, and boy, is he about to deliver. He picks up with the question I just proposed a moment ago after looking at Romans 3, and that is, if we're a bunch of sinners that deserve punishment, how can God also be righteous and just to save us? For I passed on to you, as most important, what I also received, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures. God is righteous and just to forgive sinners because the sinless Christ has taken the punishment for our sins. That is the good news. That is the essential truth claim of Christianity. And this happened in accordance with the Scriptures. That means that this was foretold in the Old Testament. This has been the plan all along. This plan has been explicitly foreshadowed since Genesis chapter 3, verse 15. I hope you could hear it clearly in today's Scripture reading. Isaiah 53, written hundreds of years before the birth of Jesus. Listen to what it says about his sacrificial death. Yet he himself bore our sicknesses, and he carried our pains. He was pierced because of our rebellion, crushed because of our iniquities. Punishment for our peace was on him, and we are healed by his wounds. The Lord has punished him for the iniquity of us all. He was cut off from the land of living. He was struck because of my people's rebellion. The Lord was pleased to crush him severely. He willingly submitted to death. Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures. Look at verse 4. That he was buried. Now, what does that tell us? Well, it tells us that Jesus really died. The Romans weren't into taking people off of crosses who weren't dead. He was really dead. He was really buried. Isaiah 53 foretells this as well. He was assigned a grave with the wicked, but he was with a rich man at his death. Again, hundreds of years before Jesus' birth. But then listen to Jesus' burial account from Matthew 27, beginning in verse 57. When it was evening, a rich man from Arimathea named Joseph came, who himself had also become a disciple of Jesus. He approached Pilate and asked for Jesus' body. Then Pilate ordered that it be released. So Joseph took the body, wrapped it in clean, fine linen, and placed it in his new tomb, which he had cut into the rock. So, he was buried. Verse 4, that he was raised on the third day according to the Scriptures. Though certainly not the only text, Isaiah 53 foretells this also. When you make him a guilt offering, he will see his seed. He will prolong his days, and by his hand, the Lord's pleasure will be accomplished. Paul says it has happened. Paul says that the gospel is rooted in the fact that Jesus really did die, and that he really was buried, and that he really did walk out of the tomb. And he's about to prove it to you. But before he defends its claim, let's look and see how much is riding on his claim. Just how crucial is the reality of the resurrection to the gospel? If you're in your Bibles, look down at verse 12. Now, if Christ is proclaimed as raised from the dead, how can some of you say there is no resurrection of the dead? If there's no resurrection of the dead, then not even Christ has been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, then our proclamation is in vain, and so is your faith. Moreover, we are found to be false witnesses about God because we have testified wrongly about God that he raised up Christ, whom he did not raise up, if in fact the dead are not raised. If the dead are not raised, not even Christ has been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, your faith is worthless. You are still in your sins. Those then who have fallen asleep in Christ have also perished. If we have put our hope in Christ for this life only, we should be pitied more than anyone. It is downright critical to the gospel that Jesus actually walked out of that tomb. And Paul says that if he didn't, we are wasting our time. We are wasting our lives. Our faith is worthless. We have no forgiveness for our sins. We are going to die and go to hell. We are the single most pitiful group of people on the face of this planet. So as Paul moves to defend the resurrection, understand that he is defending the very thing that the gospel is grounded in. Whether the gospel checks out or not hinges fully on whether Jesus was resurrected or not. Whether Christianity sinks or floats rides on whether Jesus walked out of that tomb or not. Did he? Paul says so. Can you back it up? Let's see. For I passed on to you, is most important what I also received, that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day according to the scriptures, verse 5, and that he appeared to Cephas. A simple, straightforward claim that Jesus appeared to the apostle Peter. Cephas is another name for Peter. Now, we don't have any other account of this specific appearance anywhere else in scripture. Scripture doesn't record anything else about a post-resurrection meeting between Jesus and Peter only. But you certainly don't have to read very far to find out about Peter's confidence that he had encountered the risen Jesus. Acts chapter 2. This is Peter's sermon on the day of Pentecost, words that come straight from Peter's mouth. He says, "Fellow Israelites, listen to these words. This Jesus of Nazareth was a man attested to you by God with miracles, wonders, and signs that God did among you through him, just as you yourselves know. Though he was delivered up according to God's determined plan and foreknowledge, you used lawless people to nail him to a cross and kill him. God raised him up, ending the pains of death because it was not possible for him to be held by death." Verse 32, "God has raised this Jesus. We are all witnesses of this." He really saw the risen Jesus. Jesus really appeared to him. And just as a side comment, remember that the last thing we were told about Peter before the resurrection is that he explicitly denies Jesus. It's a good reminder for us that our spiritual life is built on God's faithfulness, not our own. Philippians chapter 1, verse 6. "I am sure of this, that he who began a good work in you will bring it to completion at the day of Jesus Christ. Thanks be to God that he holds my salvation in his hands." If it was about my faithfulness to him instead of his faithfulness to me, I would be in trouble. Verse 5. "That he appeared to Cephas, then to the 12. Now, the 12 is simply a title for the closest disciples of Jesus. It doesn't mean that all 12 of them were present. In fact, it can't in this instance because Judas has already killed himself. The gospel accounts tell us that Thomas was absent from this encounter. With a name like Thomas, he must have had a good reason. Maybe he was out trying to get a head start on evangelism or something. Probably not, definitely not. But that's my story, and I'm sticking to it. But we see this in John chapter 20, in Luke chapter 24, that the disciples of Jesus are gathered in one place on that first Easter evening, and Jesus appears in their midst. Now, these are going to be the guys who are the foundation of the church. These are going to be the first people to preach the gospel after the ascension. Virtually all of these guys are going to be killed for their belief that Jesus is indeed who he says he is. I think it's pretty important that they saw the risen Jesus. And before they went and lived their lives in constant threat of death for proclaiming the gospel and eventually being martyred for that reason, you best believe that they truly had encountered the risen Jesus. Verse 6. Then he appeared to more than 500 brothers and sisters at one time. Most of them are still alive, but some have fallen asleep. I've got an observation and a question. Observation, that is a significant amount of people. Question. Why does Paul say most of whom are still alive? Well, it turns out you are a lot more credible when you have witnesses. So, I'm sitting in my room on a Monday night, my junior or maybe sophomore year of college, anyway. And I'm sick. I feel awful. And I get a text from Lawrence. We have a campus outreach meeting that night. So I get a text from Lawrence. He says, hey, are you coming to campus outreach? And I said, well, I wasn't really planning on it. I feel pretty bad. He says, well, they asked me to tell a story at the beginning of the meeting, and I was wondering if you could come. I said, okay, I will make it. So I walk into campus outreach late, and Lawrence is already in the middle of telling his story, and I immediately realize why Lawrence wants me there. Because he is telling the story of the time we went to a Clemson football camp between our freshman sophomore year of high school. And we're at this camp sitting around in a dorm room with a bunch of guys we don't know, and we're just sitting there talking, killing some time, and one of the guys looks at us and says, now, how do y'all know each other? And before I can say anything, Lawrence says, oh, we're brothers. And the guy's like, oh, okay, so y'all are boys. Lawrence's like, no, we're brothers. So now, if you're having a hard time putting together, like, why this is a hard sell, the issue is that I'm a Caucasian. Lawrence is African-American. Now, as many things as me and Lawrence may be, biological brothers is not one of them. But we didn't back down because Lawrence has come up with this elaborate scheme about how when we were in the womb, there was some kind of complications. It caused a pigment problem. He comes out black. I come out white. Now, the guys that we're telling this to are still pretty skeptical, but our cause really gets advanced when one of the guys says, hey, I did see there was two white people that came and picked them up last night. We said, yeah, our parents. So, long story short, there are like four dudes in the world that think me and Lawrence are twins. Pretty unbelievable. And Lawrence knew that when he walked into campus outreach to tell them something pretty unbelievable, it would be more convincing if he could cite a witness. So, I went to campus outreach and I was his witness. He told his side of the story, I told my side of the story, everything checked out. Now, while the content is drastically different, Paul's function in verse 6 functions very much like Lawrence referencing me as a witness. Just like I was a real person and alive to tell what I had experienced, Paul says these are real people and they are alive to tell you what they have experienced. When 1 Corinthians was written, Paul had several hundred people that he knew would testify about what they had experienced. He was so confident that they would testify to what they had experienced that he could put it in writing in the first century Roman Empire. The same Roman Empire that killed Jesus. A Roman Empire that is now being impacted by Christianity. A Roman Empire that is now persecuting, executing, hunting down Christians simply for the fact they are Christians. So this isn't some minor issue that nobody cares about. The resurrection of Jesus was an absolute shockwave that is still felt today. It's fairly obvious that what happened on the first Easter morning is the single most important event in all of history. And as such, you can't proclaim to have hundreds of witnesses to it if you don't have hundreds of witnesses to it. These people were real people. Real people ready to testify that they had really encountered the risen Jesus and they could care less that it might cost them their lives to do it. Verse 7. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles. So James is the half-brother of Jesus, the biological son of Joseph and Mary. What do we know about Jesus' half-brothers? Well, John 7 gives us some good insight. These are the first five verses. They read like this. After this, Jesus traveled in Galilee, since he did not want to travel in Judea because the Jews were trying to kill him. The Jewish festival of shelters was near, so his brothers said to him, "Leave here and go to Judea so your disciples can see your works that you are doing. For no one does anything in secret while he's seeking public recognition. If you do these things, show yourself to the world, for not even his brothers believed in him." Okay, so his brothers are rooting for him to get killed. His brothers do not believe in him. They were raised in the same household as Jesus, and they literally have no clue what is going on. But that is prior to his crucifixion and resurrection. What's up with James after the crucifixion and resurrection? Well, in Acts chapter 15, we see him as a key spokesman at the Jerusalem Council. He was a prominent figure in the early church. He wrote the book of James. He goes from hating Jesus and wanting to get Jesus killed in John 7 to living for Jesus and risking his life to proclaim the gospel. How does that happen? Then he appeared to James. That's how that happened. James really encountered the resurrected Jesus, and it flipped his life upside down. He isn't the only one who gets his life flipped upside down. Turns out there's this guy named Paul. Look at verse 8. "Last of all, as to one untimely born, he appeared also to me." Paul was a well-educated, well-respected, highly prominent, notably zealous Jew. He did not believe in Jesus. He eagerly persecuted anyone who did believe in Jesus. He appears in Scripture for the first time at the end of Acts chapter 7, where we see him looking on with approval as the Jews stone Stephen to death for his profession of Jesus. So how does he go from that place in his life to being the greatest frontline missionary of all time and writing a significant portion of the New Testament? "He appeared also to me." Paul encountered the risen Jesus, and it radically changed the course of his life. He lived for Christ. He died for Christ. In 66 AD, the Romans cut his head from his body with a sword for preaching the gospel. And among the last words he ever wrote is this proclamation: "I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith." He took his stand in the gospel. He held fast to the gospel. A question for you this morning as we close: if those who know you best were to look at your life, would they see evidence that you have actually taken your stand in the gospel and are holding fast to the gospel? If the answer is no, or some version of no, like "not really" or "I'm not too sure," then you desperately need to do that. You've never given your life to Jesus, you have never actually taken your stand in the gospel, if you've never publicly confessed Christ as your Savior, then I would invite you to do that this morning. Believing in vain will not save you. The hymn of response is coming in roughly 90 seconds, and I will be right here to discuss anything you would like to discuss. What if the answer is yes? And thanks be to God that there are some here who have taken their stand in the gospel. For those of us who are in that camp, I challenge you this morning to let this passage recalibrate your life. Paul says that the gospel is grounded in the resurrection of Jesus, and he goes on to say that the resurrection of Jesus is the grounds for our hope of the life to come. Look ahead to verse 20 if you still have your Bibles open. "But as it is, Christ has been raised from the dead, the firstfruits of those who have fallen asleep. For since death came through a man, the resurrection of the dead also comes through a man. For just as in Adam all die, so in Christ all will be made alive. But each in his own order: Christ the firstfruits, afterward it is coming those who belong to Christ." If you've taken your stand in the gospel, understand that eternity is coming. Do not get caught up in the things of this world. Do not get bogged down in the trials and temptations of this life. Get caught up in making much of God. Get caught up in living to glorify a risen Lord. The new creation is coming. Live like it. I'll leave you this morning with Revelation 21. "Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. Also saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared like a bride adorned for her husband. Then I heard a loud voice from the throne, "Look, God's dwelling is with humanity, and he will live with them. They will be his peoples, and God himself will be with them and will be their God." Let's pray. Oh Lord, we come before you a thankful people this morning. Thankful, Lord, that you have not left us without witness to what you have done. Lord, those of us who have taken our stand in the gospel are thankful that you intend to dwell again with us. You will be our God, and we will be your people. Lord, we thank you, and we look forward expectantly to that day. But my great fear is that there are some here who, quite frankly, are not ready for that day. They have not yet taken their stand in the gospel. And Lord, I pray that you might lead them to do that this morning. Inasmuch as we stand in the gospel, we stand on a firm foundation. Lord Jesus, your resurrection is as real to me as my next breath. And Lord, may it be so for many others this morning. May some who have never trusted in you, trust in you. Because your resurrection is real, and it has consequences. I pray this in Jesus' name, and by his grace, and for his glory. Amen.
Our song of invitation this morning is changed from in the bulletin. It's 358, Because He Lives. Our words are up here. So let's stand together and sing, Because He Lives. Thank you.
have intentions of re-preaching Thomas' sermon. Listen to me very carefully. If you die and go to hell, you can't say to God, I never heard the gospel. Because if you never heard it before, you heard it this morning. That 15th chapter I've been looking at myself, Thomas, because I think it's the clearest picture of the gospel of Jesus you'll find anywhere in the Bible. Clear. Jesus lived. Jesus died. Jesus was buried. And praise God, he's coming again. That's the gospel. Somebody's asking me this morning, preacher, how many people do you think in the church who attend regularly are going to die and go to hell? Billy Graham said before he died, it was as many as 75% of people who attend church. You've seen the numbers. Will die and go to hell. Satan's biggest tool is deception. People believe because they joined the church. It's been one of the biggest burdens in my heart for many years. It gets greater and greater. Joining the church, being baptized, living a good life won't take you to heaven. Here it is. Here it is. And we're getting near the end. I heard a man say this week, I was telling somebody, a prominent man said this week, I'm the Messiah. I said, thank you, Lord. Another proof. Because the Bible says in the last days, many, many will claim to be a Messiah. But only Jesus is Messiah. Thank you, Thomas. I wish I knew that every young man in the seminary were going to come out and preach the gospel the way Thomas Broom is going to preach the gospel. I'd feel a whole lot better. Every time he stood in this pulpit, Thomas, you have preached the gospel as clear as anybody could ever preach the gospel. We thank you. We thank your parents for bringing you up in the nurture and admonition of Jesus. Now, it's two Sundays to listen to me. Two Sundays to Easter. Please, please, please read Matthew 26, 27, 28. Particularly that portion about the Lord's Supper we're going to observe next Sunday. I know many of you are visiting to hear Thomas. If you don't have a church home, you don't attend church regularly, we encourage you, invite you to come back and join with us the next two Sundays as we observe Palm Sunday next Sunday, and we observe Easter Sunday the following Sunday. God bless you. We praise you, Father. I'm excited because there are young men today coming out of our seminaries who believe the gospel, unashamedly preach the gospel. And among those people is Thomas Broom. Thank you for him. Pray you'd continue to put your hand upon him. I pray you'd bind Satan from him. I pray you'd cover him with the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, that he'll not succumb to the evils of the world, knowing that Satan is a great deceiver. Father, I also pray this morning the gospel has not fallen upon deaf ear. Your word says your word will not return to you void. I pray the Holy Spirit of Almighty God will work in all of our lives as we leave this place today in a manner that those who are not born again cannot say with Paul, I know, before the sun sets this evening, I pray, Holy Father, they will surrender their life to Jesus as Lord and Savior, bind Satan from their minds and hearts, keep Satan from deceiving them into believing something other than Jesus, and their being born again can usher them into the kingdom of heaven. Thank you for the music today, especially for Jack and Fran. Beautiful. It's been good to be here today, Father. It's been wonderful to be in your house this morning, be able to worship you. I pray, Lord, again, you bless Thomas as he leaves tomorrow and travels that many miles through the mountains back to Louisville, Kentucky. I pray you bless him in his studies. Bless our choir as they prepare this evening further. For next Sunday, we're going to have a great day, Father. And I pray that all of these people will be in your house somewhere next Sunday, worshiping the risen Christ. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
And all God's people said,
amen.
Let's sing our closing song as we're dismissed. Jack has an announcement.
Tiffany wrote this card. Said, I cannot thank you enough for all the help and all that you have done. It means so much to myself and my family to have the community rallying around us. I could never repay you your kindness. However, I hope that this helps the youth group plan something fun. With true gratitude, the Hartleys. And she made a donation of $1,000 to the youth of this church.
Sing our closing song, Oh How He Loves You and Me.